through, as you can imagine, today. Our first item is to talk about Scotland's public finances in 23-24, the impact of the cost of living and public services reform. So welcome to the 24th meeting in 2022. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting Alison Douglas, Chief Executive of Alcohol Focus Scotland, Polly Tolley, Director of Impact at Citizens Advice Scotland, who is attending instead of Rory Mayer CBE, who could not be here today. Catherine Murphy, Executive Director at Engender. Claire Reid, Director of Policy and Public Affairs at the Scottish Council for Development and Industry. Aaron Hill, Director of Policy and Membership, Scottish Federation of Housing Associations. David Lonsdale, Director, Scottish Retail Consortium. And Stephen Smiley, Deputy Convener of Unison Scotland. So thank you everyone for your detailed written submissions. We have of course moved on a wee bit from the content of some of those submissions, given the fact we're two chancellors of the Exchequers since then, and obviously we've had this statement last week in the appointment of a new government. We also incidentally invited the Scottish Chamber of Commerce to take part in today's discussion, but have not received a response to our invitation. Exploring the written views of witnesses at committee meetings is an important part of our inquiry process, and this is the second time this session the committee has invited the Chambers of Commerce with no success. I consider it discourteous to this committee that on this occasion they haven't even responded, and I would encourage the Chamber of Commerce to contact us to discuss this, and in the meantime the committee may well wish to reflect on this when it comes to future inquiries. So we are very grateful for your attendance today and indeed your participation in person. We have around 90 minutes for this session, which is intended to generate a discussion rather than be a straightforward question and answer session. If at any time you would like to raise a point, please indicate to the clerk and I'll bring you in. I don't intend to chair the meeting the way I did last week. Obviously, I couldn't anyway. It's not a straightforward Q&A, as I mentioned already. But there have been so many changes that we may dot around a wee bit in terms of some of the issues. But we're trying to stick to some of the major issues facing us. And so I think, who would I want to bring in first? I think I'm going to bring Claire Reid in first, because taxation is obviously in the forefront of everyone's minds at the moment, following the statement last week. And you've said in your submission that, and I quote, Scotland competes with other parts of the UK and other countries to attract investment and talent, and tax rates are one of the factors. Scotland's ability to retain, grow and attract businesses and retain and attract key workers will be absolutely pivotal in generating rates of growth, which will make its public finances sustainable and fund improvements in public services and spending. So what is your view on where we should go from here with regard to taxation in Scotland?
Okay, thank you. And thank you to the committee for inviting us along this morning. I think, I suppose, just to sort of take a quick step back from that question, just to kind of reiterate, I suppose, where we are in terms of the priorities for the spending review. I think we're very keen that at this point, particularly when the indication is that we're either going into recession or are in recession, is that spending is focused on areas that support economic growth, whether that's around investment in infrastructure, attracting inward investment, or supporting businesses to grow and to create new jobs. In terms of the situation we're in at the moment, we released a statement on Friday to indicate that whilst we welcome the support for businesses and households on energy, we do have some concerns about the UK government's decision to cut taxes in the way that they have, and also to increase borrowing to levels which certainly increase the risk to the economy. In terms of where we go from here in Scotland, we've probably had a range of views from our members around whether Scottish Government should follow suit or not. I think one of the concerns is around the sort of potential increase in complication and or complexity in the tax system in Scotland versus the rest of the UK. But certainly some of the feedback we've had from members around attracting talent and growing some of the key sectors that you set out in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, that are in the Export Plan and that are likely to be in the Innovation Strategy, those are sectors that need to be able to attract talent. And I think some of the concern is around if we start to diverge significantly from the rest of the UK, that could potentially be a deterrent for some of those sectors trying to attract new talent to Scotland.
Okay, thank you. No one has said they want to come in. Stephen, just in a contrast to that, then in Unison's paper, you said, and I quote, an IPPR Scotland report last year indicated that reducing the threshold for higher income tax to £40,000 from the current £43,000 would raise £690 million. And Unison, in fact, has made a number of suggestions in terms of how tax should be raised. So what's your view on how we move forward from the point we are at following Friday's statement?
Thanks very much for the invite today. Yeah, I mean, your opening remarks reflected on the changes that have taken place and the way in which the government announced last week and the reaction to the markets and all the rest of it. I think most of us are even more worried about the economic situation now than we perhaps even were last week. Our view is that the priority for economic growth is well understood in the creation of jobs, which obviously some any trade union is in favour of. If at the same time, however, we are forced into a position of cuts in public sector spending, which result in loss of jobs, in whether it's local government or health or higher further education or any other parts of the public sector, we then have a reverse motion in terms of economic activity. Workers who work in the public sector spend their money locally, and reducing their ability to spend either through reduction in their wages, which over the past 12 years I would remind people of the austerity that public sector workers have had to experience, and the value of their wages have declined by something like 20%, and that's going to continue in the current situation with pay rises below the rate of inflation. So all of that's a drag on the economy. If that purchasing power is no longer in the community, then the local shops don't get the spending and footfall that they need to maintain. So we need to be careful not to talk about economic growth purely in terms of incoming companies. We don't accept the argument that the taxes should be cut, or indeed that the higher rate of tax remaining at its level, current level in Scotland, will have any detrimental impact on the economy. The numbers of people that involves is so small that we don't think that the talent that we have in Scotland would be able to cope with that. And the other part of that is that it's not just about what people pay in taxes, it's what they get in return for their services. As a Scottish union official, regularly going down to London to speak to colleagues in other parts of the country, people will always come back and say, thank goodness we don't live in that country, because the state of services we have up here continue to be better. They're not as good as it could be, but they continue to be better. So there's a balance there between levels of taxation and levels of service provision, and we would argue that the challenge, the opportunities which exist, should be taken in terms of finding ways to raise tax from other areas, and our paper gives a whole range of different examples of where money could be raised to assist with the problems that we have at the moment. And I would hope that the committee and the government will start looking at a whole range of these kind of areas where we could actually increase the public sector, public spending, by raising that income.
You said there, Stephen, that you didn't think there was only any likely to be any behavioural change or any impact, but about 16% of Scotland's income tax comes from 0.6% of high earners. So has Unison done any work to look at behavioural change and where the tipping point is? So, for example, I remember asking this in the Basque Country some years ago, and their view was that if there was a 2 or 3% differential, there would be no behavioural change, but after that, that's when behaviour did start to change and it became more economically valuable to those who would consider such change, i.e. people who are high incomes and are mobile. So I would ask that. And also, anyone else who's going to comment in this area, what you have research you have in terms of behavioural change, or because It's not just opinions, of course, that matter. It's evidence that matters, I think.
I mean, I have to confess, I don't think Unison's done any specific research on that. We could quote our own. We refer to the IPPR research, which makes comments about the banding. So we don't have any of individual research. What we do have evidence of is skill shortages and shortages in labour at the lower ends of the jobs market. In social care, we continue to have a recruitment crisis, as people are well known at the moment. There's a whole range of areas of that where people in key industries, the key workers who we all clapped during the COVID pandemic, continue to be on very low wages, and we continue to struggle to recruit people at that level. That's where the priority has to be. I have to say, I think there's sufficient talent at for example, in the local authority, the cleaner a full-time cleaner would be on something like £18,000 a year. The changes in tax will benefit them by, couple of hundred pounds at best, whereas the chief executive, who's on £180,000, will get significantly more benefit from the tax. But that chief executive is not about to start looking elsewhere go to England or elsewhere for the work. They're part of an integrated service. So I don't think there's evidence, but I accept what you're saying, convener, that I don't, from a union's perspective, can't present any evidence of that. But our strong belief is that is not the priority area at this point in time.
Okay, thank you. Ross, to be followed by John.
Thanks, convener. Interesting following this up with Stephen, because I found Unison's submission really helpful in that this committee always has a whole range of organisations who come to us wanting more spending in the areas that they prioritise, but very few folk are willing to come with proposals on A, how you raise additional money to pay for that, or B, what you would cut from elsewhere to do it. That being said, as much as I think the proposals that Unison have brought forward in terms of revenue raising are tangible and mostly deliverable, even if they were collectively maximised, that wouldn't raise enough money to match the level of spending commitments that Unison are looking for. So I'm interested in what the union's view on prioritisation is. Is it free school meals? Is it increasing NHS funding? Is it keeping public sector pay up in line with inflation? How should Parliament be looking to prioritise in a context where, at least in the short term, over the next 2 to 3 years, we certainly can't do everything on your spending list all at once?
The question you've asked are excellent. In fact, I was going to ask something almost exactly the same moving on, but I'm trying to keep the thing to tax so that we don't end up jumping about completely, because I want to try and... I do want Stephen to answer that question at the appropriate point, but I want to try and keep to the issue of tax.
Yeah, we can tell that later, that's fine.
And then we can move on to that. But it's an excellent question. As I said, it was something I was going to move on to myself. Do you want to ask anything on the kind of tax issue?
It's the same question at its core about prioritisation. So some of the tax proposals in Unison's submission would require primary legislation. They are new tax powers. So I'm interested, again, of those, given the legislative timetable is pretty tight over the next couple of years, which are the brand new proposals? Is it the local inheritance tax? Is it replacement of council tax? Which of those would you prioritise for parliamentary and government time?
That's a difficult... Thanks very much, Ross. Please write to me in advance of these questions. I couldn't say specifically. These are ideas which we've been discussing in Unison for some time and have been subject to various discussions at STUC level, for example, and I think in previous submissions to various different committees here. So I couldn't say categorically which ones are the immediate priorities. That would be subject to, I think, to be fair, deliberations here amongst ourselves. I think the point that we're making is that too much is said about a fixed budget. We've only got a fixed budget, or we're entirely relying on what we get from Westminster. And that's a critical issue, and we would certainly support the idea that the Scottish Government, the Westminster Government, should change its tack so that there's more money going into the public sector. But within that, the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament, has those powers that they can actually introduce additional means of raising funding, and we should be less shy about staying away from that. Because of fears of some people from certain quarters who would always come down and say, the Tax Dodgers Alliance, for example, will always criticise anyone who suggests raising taxes. We think we should be looking at how we introduce a far more progressive taxation which will bring in more money. Now, these are just suggestions. I couldn't say which ones you should do first. But I think we should start looking at them seriously as a parliament, as a country, as to how we make taxation more progressive.
Thanks. Happy to come back in later, Convener.
Sure. Thank you. John, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. And I think on the same kind of theme, and as I've got David Lansdale sitting next to me, I was going to ask the Scottish Retail Consortium how they've...
It's coming in after Daniel as well.
All right. Oh, well, that's a good time.
But you can come in before me.
So, because if I understood from their submission, they'd like lower business rates, they'd like probably lower income tax so that consumers have more money to spend in the shops. I mean, would you also take a view like Unison that we could raise some other taxes to compensate, or how do you see this balance between raising tax and losing money?
Would you like me to come back in now?
Just now, yeah, but you'll still eat your bit, don't worry, in a couple of minutes.
Look, so thank you for the invitation, and just in terms of reeling the film back a little touch, just to give the context of what our budget recommendations are about. Obviously, retail has been in the eye of the storm over the last 2.5 years, somewhat perverse that we've had a very tough pandemic, and then we're straight into this costs emergency, as the First Minister has described it. And so obviously retailers and their customers are facing into that. And that's the prism through which we look at the Scottish budget and our recommendations paper. And yes, we have put forward a number of tax proposals in our budget recommendations paper. In terms of business rates, just to pick up on what you were saying, Mr. Mason, we've asked for a potential hike in the business rate to be ruled out. So we've not technically asked for a cut, but one can look at that as one does. In terms of income tax, in our budget submission, we talked about ruling out any increases for those on modest earnings. We also go on to say if there were obviously tax cuts at the UK level, then we'd like to see those people on lower and modest earnings benefit from that similarly. That was in our budget paper, and obviously can come on to that in a moment. And then in terms of raising new taxes, we tend to be somewhat not hugely in favour of additional taxes. We think that obviously retailers and other businesses are paying quite enough as it is in several taxes. So, for example, on the business rate, it's at a 23-year high at the moment. And if I understand the potential for next spring, we could be seeing a 10% uplift. So for retailers in Scotland alone, that would be an extra £60 million plus next year. We've obviously outlined a number of suggestions about how one might look at to save taxpayers' money or public expenditure. There's an entire chapter on that. Happy to go further and explain on that. In terms of research and evidence, there probably isn't a tremendous amount behind that, but there are a few suggestions that we've pointed to as well. But I'm happy to come back on some of the other points.
Yes. We'll be covering other areas as we progress.
If I could, convener, can I have another point?
Yes, John.
At Claire Reid, I think, if I may, from SCDI. If I understand you correctly, you didn't like the idea of fiscal drag so that effectively people do pay more tax just because of inflation and things. And I think your argument was that productivity would be a better, increasing productivity would be a better way of doing things. But so my question for you is more on timing, that even if we do improve productivity, that is, we're probably talking 3, 4, 5, 10 years, whereas fiscal drag can help the finances now, can't they?
Well, yes, but actually we think there's things that could be done to support productivity now. You know, I suppose we are probably more in favour of thinking about how investment can be prioritised to support economic growth and to support the strategies and plans that Scottish Government is looking to bring forward, not least the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. So I guess part of our focus is about saying, yes, tax is a lever that can be used to shore up public finances, but we need to think about the consequences of that. So, you know, the point on fiscal drag, and actually it picks up the point that was made earlier, you know, we don't have any hard evidence either, other than what members are telling us about the likelihood of people in those higher tax bands to, you know, either choose not to come to Scotland or choose to take their labour elsewhere. But one thing I would note just on that is, I think from the data, the suggestion is that, you know, the number of people who will be in that higher tax bracket will go from 7 to 17% by 2027-28. Now, that's quite a large proportion of the economy. So, you know, I think we just have to think about the consequences of that. we would prefer to think about ways that we can support businesses now. So, I mean, we've asked our members and they've come up with a variety of things that would help them at the moment. So David has talked about one of them, which is, you know, not to increase non-domestic rates in the spring. They've asked us to think about ways that government can reduce the burden on businesses, so not to introduce any other new costs to business in the short term, to continue to support flexible and affordable childcare, and to support them to invest in the things that they're having to do, like reduce their energy costs and to upskill their workers. So I would say that there probably are quite a lot of things that could be done in the short term to improve productivity, and certainly our, I suppose, the case that we've made. So we're not, and I suppose just on the broader point about you know, higher tax rates in Scotland versus elsewhere, I suppose our perception is that probably people can stand a sort of perhaps a slight differential in Scotland from elsewhere, but we just need to be mindful of the gap that could widen up in the kind of current context. But as I say, our focus probably is more on making sure we've got the right investment in the right places for the long-term sustainable growth of Scotland's economy.
We'll come back to some of these things as well. Dan, to be followed by David.
Just make a brief comment about something Stephen said earlier. I mean, I think it's actually quite important to note that a lot of Scotland's higher earners are actually in the public sector. We've got a different profile of higher earners, and so some of those tax points actually don't have the same impact in Scotland, which I think is quite important to understand. But so before I ask my question, I actually ought to remind the committee of my register of interests. I'm a director and sole shareholder in a company that has retail interests, which is probably understating the level of bias I have towards the retail sector, quite frankly. But let me ask David some key questions. I mean, I think what's quite interesting in your submission is your point about non-domestic rates and the proportion that retail pays. I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit further about the impact that the non-domestic rates has on retail, and actually critically, and you know, to echo this, the drift of some of my colleagues' questions. I mean, what do you think should replace it? Because I think it's one thing to say that non-domestic rates doesn't work, but you know, are we looking? You know, should we be looking at something that is levied on revenue? You know, should it be a sort of property-based tax or indeed a land-based tax? Does SRC or BRC have a view of what might be fair, and actually critically, what might actually be kind of more sort of in line or even kind of synergistic with kind of economic growth and what you know, helping businesses and driving the investment in their local environments that rates might not.
Thank you for that question. There's quite a lot, lot in it. So
I wasn't going to make it easy just because I like retail.
You have a retail interest, absolutely. And as a former retailer, somebody who has a stake in the business, I'm acutely aware of your expertise in this area and experience. In terms of the proportion and the impact, so there are essentially two sort of key ingredients or outgoings for retailers. One is obviously their staffing complement, the costs around that, and the second tends to be their property footprint, of which the non-domestic rates bill alongside rents can be the largest component. And as I said earlier on in response to John Mason, you know, the poundage rate, for example, now, as I say, is at a 23-year high. I think it's gone up from something like 41% to 49%, which is some in the region of 20% over the last 11 years or so. So when it was brought in, it was at, I think it was at somewhere in the region of 35% when we had the uniform business rate brought in about 15, 20 years ago. So the tax has been, it's one of these sort of hidden taxes. It's not actually called a tax rate. It's got a fancy name like poundage rate. So it's somewhat hidden in that respect. So that's why it's such a big factor for the industry, obviously at a time, as you've alluded to, that the sector, like other sectors, has gone through quite profound structural changes as well. So more retailers obviously taking place now online than was previously, and that's been accelerated somewhat throughout the pandemic as well. So that's the sort of context in terms of the scenario in terms of why it's an important tax to the retail industry. In terms of the replacement, that's where it gets a little bit thorny. Obviously, both governments here in Scotland at a UK level over the last 15, 20 years have tried Some have tried and some have attempted to change local government taxation, and it's been quite tricky at times as well. The long and the short of it is we've put forward a number of proposals, and actually the Scottish Government have adopted several of them, so we've got more regular revaluations coming into effect from spring of next year, and in theory that should make the rate system more responsive to trading conditions, so that's a positive. But the long and the short of it is we think the poundage rate or the tax rate needs to come down and come down on a more sustainable basis, and that's obviously one of the things we've set out. Allied to that, we have a higher property rate in Scotland. It's a slab tax. That will be of interest to a finance committee of the Parliament as well. So obviously, if you're paying, if you're liable for that slab tax, that cascades right down your entire valuation as well. And the reality is that there are 3,000 shops and 12,000 businesses overall in Scotland who are paying that. And that means that they're paying a slightly higher tax rate if they were, say, down south, for example.
Thank you. I mean, one of the things that struck me is actually the fact that you know, 20% of business rates being paid by retail when they are, you know, very crudely, it's about 10% of the economy, which I mean, I think in stark terms sets at that context. I just wanted to ask another question, and I think one of the areas where I understand your wariness of things like tourist tax. But I think, you know, individual levies like that can be useful levers for local government. I think, you know, if I'm being candid, I think my worry is that introducing them one by one encourages local authorities to put them up to the max. And I'd rather see a basket of different levies. And I just would put to you, and actually I'd be interested if other people would chime in, you know, if we designed those correctly, could they not be beneficial by ensuring that local economic activity gets invested in towns, cities and local environments, which actually should be mutually beneficial both for the businesses that want to do business there and the people that want to live there. So is it about getting it right rather than being wrong in principle? And I would be interested if other people have a view on that.
Certainly, I think your point about having a less piecemeal approach to local taxes or taxes in Scotland and a more coherent approach is the fundamental one, because we've had a number of these sort of taxes come forward. You mentioned obviously the tourism tax, which I think is on the statute books or is going to be on the statute books. The workplace parking levy is on the statute books, but I don't think any councils have implemented it thus far. We've obviously got some thoughts on that. That's in our budget submission as well. There was an attempt immediately before the pandemic to end the uniform business rate in Scotland, allow the 32 councils to set their own business rate. That potentially opens the door to local supplements and things like that. So certainly a more coherent approach would be very, very welcome. In terms of individual taxes, we're open to discussions. I think we make clear in our budget recommendations paper about council tax, which Mr. Greer alighted on earlier on. We're open to that discussion. I guess where we would come from is, what does it mean for consumer spending? Are we going to bring in more tax or less tax? What does it mean for disposable incomes? What do alternatives mean for businesses? So one of the original ideas under the current government here in Scotland was a local income tax. That had some implications for employers to administer it, because obviously at the moment each of us administer our own council tax. So that's another aspect to it. And then the third aspect would be, what would that mean for non-domestic rates, which is obviously a key tax. So there are various considerations. We're up for these discussions.
Thanks very much. Now, I've only two other folk who've said they want to comment on tax, which is actually David and Claire again. So if anyone else wants to speak about this particular issue, please do so. I'll let you in, and then Stephen after Claire. So David, let you in. Incidentally, David, I found it curious in your submission that you said you wanted to reduce the number of local authorities, rates, assessors, quangos and planning authorities. I don't want to go into all that, but I did find it bizarre that you want to reduce the number of rates assessors. There's already a chronic shortage, and how does that help not having people to effectively assess properties?
That's a sort of mischaracterisation, if I may, of what our position is.
Savings might accrue from reducing the number of local authorities, rates, assessors, quangos and planning authorities, it says in your submission.
Yeah, so we're not saying have fewer people undertaking rates assessments. What we're saying is there scope to reduce the number of bodies overall there are? And I think that goes with the grain of the Finance Secretary when she unveiled the spending review. I think she talked about there are 200 public bodies in Scotland and maybe we need to try and reduce some of that. There's one rates body south of the border, the Valuations Agency, covering the entirety of England, and I think also Wales as well.
Assessment bodies, not rates assessors, as it's written here?
Correct.
Okay, so it's an error in your submission then?
I wouldn't say that, but it's certainly about the number of bodies. I could quickly open and have a quick look at the document, but we talk about the number of public bodies in there, local authorities and others, and we do make that suggestion.
Okay, now, what was the comment you were going to make on taxation, if you're going to make one?
Yeah, you asked about tax in the context of the new Chancellor's growth plan on Friday, and I'm conscious of been asked a few questions and spoken quite a lot, but just to give you a quick sort of heads up on our position on that, we'd like the idea of reeling back on the national insurance contributions increase, both for employees and employers. Retail was the largest private sector employer, so you can imagine it has quite a hefty bill when that was increased. That's a positive. Something that got less notice on Friday was another U-turn. This was on tax-free shopping. And so the Scottish Government wrote to the UK Government about this time 2 years ago, asking them to think again about rescinding tax-free shopping. So it was good to see that U-turn announced on Friday. We think that will be beneficial for various parts of the retail industry in Scotland as well. And then obviously it's not tax, but energy prices and the move to try and blunt the announcement and the impact on business was welcome. There were, as I say, obviously the income tax thing doesn't necessarily apply in Scotland, and we've got some ideas in our budget submission as to how we should proceed in a Scottish context as well.
Okay, thanks. Now, it's Claire and then Stephen. And Claire, you talked about fiscal drag, but of course, on its announcement on Friday, there was no change in thresholds either, so it's fiscal drag on a UK-wide basis as well, is it not?
Yeah, absolutely, I would agree, yeah. But I think I suppose I was just making a point that you know, it can be a blunt instrument to bring more people into the tax threshold, and it's part of, I guess, a mix of tools that you'll have at your disposal to think about that. So I suppose I was making the point that sort of in addition to thinking about the rates themselves, you've already got the issue of the thresholds. The point I was going to come in on, I've actually made already with respect to that, but if I could just maybe add a point on Daniel's point about the tourist tax. So we are often asked, you know, we have regular meetings with the civil servants within government about what business want at the moment. And I think there is scope to think about sort of, you know, tax and how tax happens at a local government level, for example. And we have encouraged in our submission, you know, completion of the local government's review and also looking at the sort of fiscal framework for local government. But I would say certainly the message we've had quite strongly from members is certainly at this point, and facing all the challenges that they have in terms of rising costs, this is probably not the time to introduce new taxes on business, I would say.
Okay, moving swiftly on to Stephen to be followed by Alison.
Yeah, thanks. Just to come back on a couple of points, I would have to say that I represent hundred thousand members in Scotland who would aspire to be in the higher tax brackets, to be perfectly honest. Low pay is still the scourge of the public sector and, frankly, Scottish society. There is merit in discussing, for example, the national insurance raise, which I think most people around this table probably at the time opposed, because that was taking money directly out of low paid disproportionately than the higher paid. I want to come in on the point about two points. One on the reduction in public bodies that David refers to, and I'm glad we've clarified it's not the assessors you're after, it's the valuation boards and people that, which are already shared services. So they don't exist in every local authority. They're shared between Lanarkshire, where I come from. It's a North and South Lanarkshire shared body that it does the assessors as well as the electoral roll and other things that they're responsible for. I don't think there's much merit and going to the centralised models that they have elsewhere. There is a point here about local accountability and local democracy, which I don't think we can throw out the baby with the bathwater when we're talking about that. The drive towards centralisation is not, I think, necessarily a progressive move, and I'd want to say that. The tourist tax is just one example of where local authorities could be given, should be given, more leeway to raise funds at a local level, which they would be democratically accountable for if they wish to raise particular taxes, but specifically they would be raised.
Sorry, Stephen, are you not worried, though, that some local authorities, Argyll and Bute Highland and Edinburgh, for example, would benefit disproportionately from such a tax as opposed to, for example, North Lanarkshire or Clackmannanshire or some of the other local authorities?
Convener, from a Lanarkshire perspective, I'd have to point out there's lots of tourist attractions in Lanarkshire.
I was planning a holiday in Coatbridge.
No, I appreciate
myself,
the point you're making. I should invite you to come on holiday in Lanarkshire. It's a great place. I think that the point is that local authorities should have greater flexibility and greater powers at a local level to raise taxes appropriately for local expenditure. Now, I appreciate the point you're making, and I remember in a previous debate, I did suggest that tourist taxes, there could be an element of pooling, so that Edinburgh, which would no doubt be the one who could potentially raise far more, there could be a central pooling, so they keep most of it, some of it could be pooled, and that could assist tourist development elsewhere. The point about tourist taxes is what the money would be for. And I think there would be concerns that it was simply to be used to fill the coffers of the local authority for no specific purpose. If it was to enhance the experience of tourists to make a better visit attraction, then there would be genuine benefits to local people and local businesses and local workers for that. And the point is that local authorities should have more powers to raise those sort of things for local priorities. And we should always remember that local democracy and local accountability has to be central to it. So the idea that you can just continue to suck up essentially defeats the purpose in the long term. You need to have that local accountability so that local taxpayers, local businesses, local workforces can engage in discussions about what their priorities are locally. And I don't think we should forget that aspect of the tax raising has to be spread out, not just at central level, but at local level as well.
OK, thanks for that. Now, I'm going to bring Alison in as the last person to talk about taxation. And, of course, in your submission, Alison, you've talked about increasing minimum unit pricing from 50 to 65 pence, which obviously will have implications. So, to you.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to meet with the committee this morning. I think, in principle, we're advocating for a polluter pays tax in relation to the sale of alcohol, and it really relates to what Daniel was talking about the opportunity to raise funds at local level for investment in treatment and services, but also prevention and enforcement. Alcohol costs Scotland £3.6 billion each year. Despite what David was talking about the challenges which retailers are facing, there's no doubt that they have been making increased profits on the sale of alcohol as an unintended consequence of minimum unit price. If we look at what the business and regulatory impact assessment assessed that at, it was £40 million of additional revenue per year. So over the 4.5 years that minimum unit price has been in place, we're talking about £180 million of additional revenue. And it's clear that that's going into larger retailers, but also smaller retailers who are talking about how they are able to compete with larger supermarkets. Now, it's not just a question of inequity. It's also that this creates the unintended consequence that those retailers are therefore seeing alcohol as a more profitable part of their business, making them more likely to promote alcohol and to rely on that as part of their business model. And we think that that's distinctly unhelpful when we have such a chronic relationship with alcohol in Scotland, one which has been getting worse during the pandemic, with alcohol-specific deaths rocketing, going up 17% in 2020.
So in terms of both the point of principle of fairness and the additional revenue being used for public good, but also the practicalities of how this is distorting business models, we think that a tax that is ideally based on the amount of alcohol sold, but if not, then a proxy for that through non-domestic rates would be an extremely helpful way forward.
Thanks very much. I have to say, though, that that was one of a number of suggestions about how we could raise revenue, because obviously all the submissions are disproportionately weighted, more or less, in favour of additional expenditure. And we are in a situation whereby there are significant in-year reductions in the money available to the Scottish Government. There was a 5.2% real-terms reduction in revenue, 9.8% in capital this year, and that was with a 2.4% inflation assumption, which has now been blown out of the water at over 10%. So the point that Ross made earlier was very significant. And Stephen, I'm going to let you answer the points that Ross asked in a minute. But first of all, I want to bring Catherine in, because there's quite a compelling submission from Engender about how women are disproportionately impacted by the cost of living crisis. And I just want to ask Catherine if she can speak to that for a minute or two and look at what practical steps the Scottish Government can do in its 23-24 budget to try and change that.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today, to the committee. First of all, as someone from Coatbridge, just to reassure you that there's lots of places to visit.
I've been to Drumkeller Park many times.
Drumkeller Park is very beautiful this time of year. I would say that the key messages that we would want to get across today to the committee are, and listening to the discussion about taxation, you know, there's some stuff that's relevant to that also, but I think is that we're looking, you know, the cost of living crisis is highly gendered. We are looking down the barrel of a situation that is going to deepen inequality. Women are often the shock absorbers in families and communities with regards to poverty. Women have also borne the majority of the brunt around COVID-19 in terms of limiting the impact on their families. So to launch now into this cost of living crisis, there are going to be really serious implications for gender inequality in Scotland. So it's really great that at this moment we're getting an opportunity to discuss how this budget could be addressed. So in terms of the issues that are facing women, we have a significant and entrenched pay gap. We have wealth gaps across the life cycle. Women are overly reliant on social security, and additional caring responsibilities have major impacts for women in terms of accessing employment, training, unpaid childcare and domestic work is highly undervalued. Generally speaking, the care economy is something that is massively undervalued in Scottish society, as it is in many other countries. But that's one of the things I would want to say, is that there is massive economic potential within the care economy. It's worth approximately £8 billion a year. There is major opportunities for investment and strengthening of the care economy, and that would have a massive impact on gender equality. In terms of labour market inequality and occupational segregation, that is something that is also impacted by women's caring responsibilities. I think, to go back to your point about what can be done in this budget, one of the things I would really I want to underline is that inequality in all its forms, but you know, particularly gender equality, which I'm here to speak about, but all its forms, it's systemic and structural, and it requires a systemic and structural response. And we have some progress has been made in Scotland in recent years around gender budget analysis and integrating a more systemic budget and human rights and gender-based budgeting. But we have a long way to go, and we have a whole raft of really you know, practical, enforceable recommendations from bodies such as the Equality Budget Advisory Group, which are there ready to go, which I would encourage the committee to look at and to integrate into your pre-budget scrutiny and as far as you can. And really, I mean, how revenue is raised and how it is spent and everything in between in terms of impacts women and impacts women disproportionately and deepens inequality potentially if we don't get it right. So that would be the thing that I would say is that we need to have a more systemic approach in Scotland. And at the moment, we've made some progress. It's tentative, but we need to do more in terms of building that systemic response in terms of how our budgets are designed, how we raise revenue, that the ways that we raise revenue don't deepen inequality. And going back to what Stephen said about taking disproportionate amount of tax from income and not wealth, which impacts women disproportionately. So how we raise resources, how we spend them, but also how we evaluate them once we've spent them. And are we really achieving the outcomes that we want to achieve with the budget? And we can, you know, we can speculate, but the only way you're really going to measure that is if you have a much more systematic approach to lessening inequality in Scotland, and that's what gender and human rights budgeting offers you.
Okay, thanks very much for that. That's very helpful. I mean, obviously, any colleague who wishes to comment on that, I'm happy to do so. Michelle, you're the only person who's actually indicated they want to speak, although I'm going to let Stephen in a minute again, as I mentioned. Yes.
Well, I mean, I myself had indicated I wanted to bring in Catherine because I was so struck by the submission from Engender, and you've already highlighted the systemic nature of the issues that permeate every budget line and every facet of society. Just off the back of tax, I was reading yesterday the kind of proposed changes that were announced as part of the mini-budget last week. 80% of the benefit in higher rate tax will be realised by men, and 77% of workers earning too little to pay tax at all and therefore derive no benefit whatsoever, 77% of them are women. I suppose thinking about what this committee can do, I mean, I took a clear message from what you've said in your submission about while some good works have been done so far, it doesn't go nearly far enough in holding every single other committee, of which we lead on the budget, but who will also give some views, to account to set out specifically how their proposals will both impact on women and thinking about that backwards impact and also benefit women to start to really move the dial in terms of equality. So my question then is, would you be in favour of this committee putting a firm recommendation that every other associated committee in a parliament must do that, and indeed, I don't want to put words in your mouth, every submission into this committee, and I would gently challenge everyone here as well likewise to set that out, because I feel as though despite some good efforts and some willingness, it feels as though this is Groundhog Day in terms of conversations, the impact on women. But you're obviously the expert.
Sorry, I know you're dying to come back in, but Daniel and Claire also want to comment, and then I'll let you round up on the three.
So I just wanted to make a brief observation. I think your point around the systemic nature is absolutely spot on. I think especially thinking about, you know, social care, it's disproportionately women that work in it, you know, low pay, but we're also seeing spiralling costs of people stuck in hospital. I mean, I'm hearing constant stories of elderly people who can't go home, and I just, you know, I think the systemic thing can be both the big macro, but it's also very specific. And it'd just be sort of interesting to hear your reflections on that.
Claire.
Thank you. Sorry, I was hoping to come in on another point about prioritisation, actually, but if I can just add one point on what Catherine said, I would completely agree on the opportunity to think about health and social care, and particularly social care, as an area for investment. So some of the work that we completed last year, working with academics and the data lab, suggested that thinking about ways in which data and technology could be used to support that sector actually could bring huge social and economic benefits. So I just wanted to say that I agree with that point that Catherine made.
Yeah, I'm going to come back to you on that before too long. But Catherine, do you want to respond to these points?
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. What I would say is that when it comes to mainstream, you know, you might have heard the phrases of kind of mainstreaming, and that's about integrating a gendered response into everything that governments do. And what tends to happen when that's not being done as well as it can be is that you kind of get prioritised projects that are around inequality and gender, which you need, but that becomes kind of the fig leaf by which governments hide, and it happens all over the world. But what you need is you need a twin track of these investments in specific projects that are aimed entirely at reducing inequality, such as, you know, Equally Safe, etc., that we have in Scotland and that are great projects. But you also need an integrated through line through everything you're doing. And the situation you were describing in terms of committees is very much evidence of that, is that we tend to get invited, for example, so I'm very grateful to you for inviting us today, to the Equality and Human Rights Committee, because that's where gender is dealt with, right? But that's not where these issues should just be dealt with. And what I would say is that, and also within the budget, we're seeing that. So you have the kind of Fairer Scotland statement, which is very good at articulating what those priority projects are that are specifically aimed at dealing with inequality, but it's dealt with separately to the core budget. And what we really need is integration right through the core budget and through lines to see, well, this is how you're raising money, this is how you're spending it, and we're evaluating to see if you're achieving the outcomes and if you are lessening inequality through that investment and through that revenue raising. And that's the key to it. It's not an easy task, but it's one that we can take incremental steps to all the time. And I would just say, in response to your question specifically, completely agree with you, and I think that there is no area of policy where women aren't impacted differently in some way to men, and often more severely. The cost of living in every possible feasible way. I mean, I was reading an article recently about the highly gendered nature of inflation and the way in which, consumables, all sorts of goods that are gendered goods, as they say, the inflation is higher in many of those goods. So women are feeling it at every possible level that it is possible to feel it at, in terms of squeezing on already an over-predominance in low incomes and part-time work and care responsibilities and a gender pay gap, etc. And inflation on top of that is highly gendered. So completely agree with you.
Paula, was it this you wanted to come in on?
Please, and thank you, committee, for having me along today. I think you've spoken really passionately, Catherine, about that issue. And I suppose we would fundamentally agree with that, but I'd want to broaden that out. And I'd want to broaden that out in terms of consideration of the national performance framework and outcomes and driving that whole approach through the entire budgeting cycle. So I think what we are really keen to see is that true consideration of the delivery of the outcome for people and communities in budget setting, in tendering, in all of the sort of different facets of spending money, because we believe that that is potentially going to assist in addressing some of our fundamental issues as a society, whether that's gender inequality or income inequality. And I think that would be my ask of the committee, is, as well as taking that gendered approach, thinking about how the NPF is going to be driven forward through the budget setting process, please.
Okay, thanks. And I'm sure you'd agree with that, Catherine. Okay, so we're going to move on now, because obviously time's marching. And the point that Ross made earlier on is a very pertinent one. A lot of the increases in taxation, if the Scottish Parliament was to agree them, would have to be implemented from April, because obviously we have to, you know, do that under the Scotland Act. And we're faced with funding pressures of £1.7 billion in the current financial year. So how do we deal with those, given the financial straitjacket the Parliament actually has, Stephen?
I think politicians of all colours will talk about priorities, and trade unions are any different. So I think we all understand that we can't get... We've got a wish list that is not going to be delivered in April, and that's understood. The current situation, our priority, and in terms of the point, I would absolutely agree everything that Catherine said. As a trade union that's 75% female, we experience this all the time. We need to focus on that question of equalities,
climate change and the targets we have to reach for that are also have to be core to what we do. But the moment the priority, as far as we're concerned, has to be about enabling people to get through the cost of living crisis. That means putting money in people's pay packets appropriately. In the discussions we had recently with the Scottish Government, COSLA and the Scottish Government about local government pay, the additional monies we got from the Deputy First Minister and the First Minister in our late night sessions were about trying to achieve what we refer to as a flat rate outcome, you know, so that everybody gets the same. We didn't get that, but we did get for everybody below £40,000 a flat rate. The effect of that was that the lowest paid in local government, who are hugely predominantly female, were getting are offered and are being consulted at the moment on a pay offer of 10.5-11% of an increase. Now, that doesn't change the world for them. It's not life-changing amounts of money, but it does mean that the trade unions have prioritised trying to say the money needs to go to those people in greatest need, which happens to be the lowest paid, which predominantly is female. So we would say that that has to be the priority. And I know the government will be in discussions with every other sector of the public sector, trade unions, about pay and all the rest of it. But that needs to be recognised. We cannot continue to provide the kind of services we want to provide on poverty wages, and therefore that needs to be a priority. Beyond that, there's a whole number of what we would say we need to prioritise anti-poverty measures, and the Scottish Government Parliament have taken a lead on a whole number of the free period products, for example, is a great world-leading thing, which that fundamentally addresses the question of poverty. The expansion of free school meals would be another example of that. But I come back to the point that Catherine made about the care economy. One of the things we shouldn't do is we shouldn't spend huge amounts of money on structural change that won't actually achieve any change to the actual services that have been delivered. So the proposal for National Care Service, where hundreds of millions of pounds will be spent on drawing it up and then running another organisation, that is not the sensible approach at this point in time. That any money we've got for investment in care needs to be invested in care, not in infrastructure or moving the goalposts or moving the offices and transferring staff and all that. So I think that would be one of the things that we would say has to essentially be dropped. That's not a priority. The priority is the delivery of care.
Ross, you asked the initial question, so do you want to follow up on that?
I'm interested, beyond National Care Services is a good example. I maybe wouldn't share Unison's view on that, but that is a tangible example. There's a lot of other stuff in the submission, though, that all of it ticks the boxes you've outlined there, Stephen, in terms of priorities. So whether it's free school meals, or I presume Unison's main focus in terms of increasing funding in HE and FE is not just in terms of equity for students, but because there are substantial numbers of low-paid workers in those sectors. So how do we prioritise between these different areas of spending that would all raise wages of low-paid workers, lift children out of poverty, etc., but we can't do all of these at once is the issue we've got. So should it be free school meals, or should it be public sector pay? Should it be more funding for colleges, or more funding for universities? I realise, in principle, in our utopian world, it shouldn't be a choice between these, but certainly in the next few years, it's going to be a matter of choices. We'll have to make them, but I would be keen to know what the trade union movement's priorities would be.
I'm tempted to say that's your job. That's what we elect you for, Ross. But we'll give it a stab. Our priorities about are saying that people need to be able to cope, need to be able to heat, need to be able to buy their food, they need to be able to buy their clothes for the kids. So that's why pay isn't just about pay for workers. It's about how our people right across the spectrum survive, and that includes that. Therefore, the knock-on effect, as I said earlier on, about the economic impact of that, of people spending money locally, that generates economic development elsewhere in the economy. So we cannot get away from that fundamental that people, workers, need to get paid an appropriate rate. When inflation is heading towards wherever sky-high rate is heading towards, we need, as a government, there's a responsibility to say, right, we need to enable people to do that. The other aspects of it, I think, are part of that. So we should talk more regularly about the social wage, so free school meals and free prescriptions. We have members in Unison. As I said earlier on, we go to lots of meetings down south. We have members in Unison down south who are coming to the union saying, I can't afford to pay for my prescriptions. Now, in Scotland, we don't pay for prescriptions. So that's a really important thing. Now, Where the priorities and all that lie are a difficult one, and I don't envy the Parliament's difficulties in that. But a combination of prioritising pay, looking at where we can raise the additional income from. The one thing which I should have said earlier on, we could increase the take from council tax without primary legislation by increasing the bans, for example. We should have. I think there's been a consensus about changing the council tax for many, many years, and we've never got around to doing it. It's too hard, it's too difficult, I'm not sure what the reasons are. We should continue that work, but in the short term, there's no reason why we couldn't introduce additional bans so that people in the bigger houses, bigger properties, pay a bit more. Now, I don't have off the top of my head to tell you how much that would bring in, but that would bring in some money. So it's a combination of saying, right, what the priorities are is ensuring that people don't go into poverty, that people don't starve, people can heat their houses and all the rest of it, along with looking to see how we can increase the pot, if you like, so that the choices are maybe less difficult. If we have a bit more extra money in the pot.
OK, I've now got five people who are keen to come in, so I'll take you in the order that people indicated they wish to come in. So first will be Claire, followed by Daniel. But Claire, one of the things that jumped out at me in terms of how money could be saved, if you like, from the public sector, is your section on digitalisation. And you said, and I quote, "It has been estimated that Scotland's health and social care data could be worth £800 million every year and deliver an estimated £5,400 million in savings for NHS Scotland, 38% of its current budget and three times its predicted budget shortfall by 2025. Now, the sheer magnitude of those figures leapt right out at me. I mean, given that two-thirds of NHS budget goes on staff costs, I'm struggling to see where a 38% budget saving could be made. So I wonder if you can tell me how that could possibly be delivered and over what timescale and what the implementation costs might be, as well as, obviously, the contribution you were keen to make in the first place.
OK, thank you. So I'll take that point first, and then if I can make a comment on the prioritisation. So we undertook quite a big piece of policy work last year in conjunction with the Data Lab at Strathclyde University and the healthcare sector to look at how health and social care could benefit from better use of data and technology. It's called Mind the Gap, if anyone wants to look it up. I think we did circulate it in Parliament. So that really started to say, you know, what could we achieve if we really started to embrace data and digital in both the health and social care sectors? And the figures you're referencing came from two UK studies which we applied, and you know, appreciate these are broad assumptions, but you know, applying the same assumptions. So there were work carried out by Ernst & Young and work carried out by Dell, looking at one, the potential social and economic benefits from changing the way we use data and technology. So some of the social benefits were, they'd estimated, were around, for example, reducing the number of falls that people might have. Or there was an example given around, you know, using technology to try and predict when someone might have an asthma attack and actually the consequences for them and the healthcare system of that. So there were social benefits and there were also economic benefits that they calculated from, you know, thinking about how technology could either be used in buildings or used in delivery of healthcare. And that also included, for example, reducing the number of sick days, both in the wider workforce and in the health and social care workforce. The kind of bigger number, which we apportioned to Scotland, just according to kind of our share of population, that was really about sort of all of the different ways that data could be used. So that sort of stretches from making buildings and facilities in health and social care as
to this 5.4 billion a year, and the 800 million is specifically for the NHS. Would that be right in saying that?
No, actually, both. So the 800 million was an estimate of economic and social benefits from investing in data, and it was up to 5 billion of savings were from applying data and technology right across the health and social care. So the states, the upskilling of workers, the use of technology, the creation of a single patient record, the potential commercialisation of anonymised patient data. So it looked at all, working with academics and others, other experts in this area, we looked at all of the opportunities for improved patient outcomes and a transformed health and social care system. And one of the recommendations we made was for a transformation fund to be set up to enable some of that innovation to happen at pace.
You know, and over what time period would it take to be able to implement this? Because one of the things that we're obviously, a lot of people have said to us in evidence last week and indeed in submissions this week is that, oh, if you give us money to invest in XYZ, in 5 or 10 years we will deliver such and such savings. But the problem is that we have, as I think we would all agree, that's something we'd be keen to do, preventative agenda. I mean, some of us, John and I, were on the Finance Committee 10 years ago and we discussed all that. But the issue is, how do we actually deliver in the financial year 23-24, which is staring us in the face? It's only a few months away. So, and there's real issues about, we want to invest more, but what do we disinvest in the meantime to free up the resources to be able to do those kind of things?
So our view was that the health and social care strategy, data strategy, which is being considered at the moment, is a good place to start, and that sort of implementing that, the people who are looking at that will have quick wins and longer term agenda items that they can implement. But I imagine if you talk to any GP surgery or health board, there are probably things that they could invest in, and they are very aware of things that could make savings now with investment. So it would be interesting to think about that transformation fund as something that could be perhaps taken from other budgets but used to kind of generate change and pilot change in the short term. Just on the kind of wider point about priorities,
Before that, but what kind of timescale would be able to deliver these savings?
Well, I think realistically you're looking at a sort of 5 to 10 year time horizon, but that's not to say you have to wait for 5 to 10 years for change to happen. You know,
sure.
But you make a start and you can start to affect.
Okay.
Budgets.
Carry on, sorry.
No, that's fine, thank you. So the point I just wanted to make was around priorities, and I'm conscious of time. Stephen has spoken about the sort of the pot and increasing the pot. So I think, fundamentally as an organisation, SCDI, we have not just businesses but also other organisations, councils, universities, colleges, for example. So we represent the whole civic society. We ultimately want to get to the same place. We want to get to a place where we have good public services and we have a wellbeing economy for Scotland. So I just want to make that point up front. I think maybe where we have a slight disagreement at the moment is in terms of how we get there. So one of the things that we would encourage this committee to be thinking about is, in addition to how do we spend the pot and how do we sort of reprioritise, is what is it that we're spending, of the things that we're spending on, how many of those are going to make the pot bigger in the long term? So our concern in looking at the figures were around the reduction in 16% reduction in funding for enterprise, tourism and trade, 8% reduction in funding for colleges and universities. Those are all critical sectors that create economic growth and will allow us to increase tax revenues over the long term for all earners, not just high earners. That's one point. And I think the second point, really what we're hearing from members at the moment is there are a lot of good plans and strategies that the Scottish Government have on the books. The National Strategy for Economic Transformation is a good example. We've spent a lot of time, our blueprint and where these ideas have come from, is we took a year working with our members to develop that and put some of these ideas forward. We've then spent the best part of the last year working with government to make suggestions about where change could happen and sort of policies that could be taken forward in the National Strategy. We've also got members who've asked us about the Energy Strategy, the Good Food Nation Strategy. There are great plans that can transform the Scottish economy, generate new high-paying jobs, attract investment, but they need the support to do it. So our concern at the moment is that the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, we must deliver on that to create the long-term revenues for Scotland that we need to have the public services we want. So our plea would be to think about the prioritisation of spending and think about support for investment in infrastructure, particularly for rural areas, investment in to support the innovation strategy, which is forthcoming, investment to support the export plan, and investment for universities and colleges, which will provide the skills needs that we have to create new well-paying jobs in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Daniel, to be followed by Aaron.
Yeah, I want to ask Stephen a question, but before I do, just on that point, I mean, I think one of the key issues we've got, both from the way that the private, but actually also the way the Scottish Government conceives productivity and growth, is that they view public services as not being almost part of the economy. That actually, when public services are about 45% of the economy, actually they drive innovation, or should be driving innovation, should be driving productivity, and should be the foundation for growth. And actually, one of my criticisms of NSET is it doesn't actually have a clear space for public services and public sector within that vision for productivity and growth. But Stephen, I mean, I completely agree with you about public sector pay. And I think particularly, I think the very long-term squeeze that's been put on local government has had a direct impact on pay amongst some of the most critical workers. But we're now facing, a real crunch, and one that I don't think there's enough active discussion on, in that the public sector pay bill is about £21 billion out of a total budget of £44 billion. And we've also had vague suggestions that from the Scottish Government they want to reduce public sector headcount to pre-COVID levels. And I'm being really blunt, and I just really worry that there's a big crunch coming and people aren't being honest about it. And at the very least, I think there's a genuine challenge about people in public sector need, pay increases to meet their bills. But when you've got that macro, that high level pay bill, that's difficult. I just wondered if there's a sort of a unison view, and do you share my fear about the sort of the lack of frankness about what may be being considered in terms of public sector headcount?
To a certain extent, I don't think it was particularly hidden. The finance secretary talked about a £30,000 reduction in headcount, going back to pre-COVID levels. That's 30,000 jobs of predominantly relatively low paid, and that would, because it's local government, it would be predominantly female jobs as well. So any economic development to create jobs would be undermined by that loss of jobs in that area. And I think that would be a real mistake, because as you say, and we have always argued, that the public sector is a driver of the economy. In some areas, the public sector is the only main employer. It's the school, it's the local hospital or the doctor surgery. They create jobs in local areas. Start chipping away at that, you start undermining the local economy as well. And whole, take in South Lanarkshire, where I come from, we've got a large rural area. The school and the local health centre is the only things which provide real jobs. People do their shopping elsewhere, or they do it online. The local shops are all closed, and so on and so forth. So, if we squeeze the public sector in that way, and it does frustrate me that people talk about productivity in public sector as if we hadn't thought of that before. I've been in local government for a long, long time, and I remember all the different best values and lean working and all the different management schemes that have come in order to try and squeeze more out of a reduced workforce. And we can't. There's nothing more to squeeze in certainly local government. My colleagues in health will say the same. Further education has been squeezed really hard over the past few years. We continually want more, but we're continually given less funding for it. That can't continue. We are at a crisis point in a whole range of areas. People talk about the growing demands on care. We can't recruit enough people into care. And I'm one of people who I'm now on the bank for care, because every day I'm getting emails saying, can somebody cover a shift in one of the local authority homes? And because that's the state we're in. It's the same in the early years. We all understand the need for excellent childcare, but we struggle to recruit and retain people to work in that field because their wages are not great. So the whole productivity in public sector language is just about squeezing more out of fewer people. That can't go on. We need to invest in public services in order to create the safer, better communities, the more equal communities that we all aspire to. There's no other way around it. You undermine the public services in the way in which squeezing public sector funding over many years has, then you end up having a economy which is starting to crumble, because the infrastructure, the social infrastructure, isn't there to sustain people in work, because they have to look after their parents, or they can't look after they've got to look after their kids, and so on and so forth. Okay. This is integral to the future.
Aaron, I am trying to get into so many people. There's so many people now wanting to speak. I'm trying to get as many folk in as possible. Aaron, in terms of your submission, you've said that we believe that funding for affordable housing should be prioritised alongside the health and social care and social security spending in the coming budget. And I think there's a lot of sympathy for that. You say investing in high-quality affordable housing should be understood as preventative spending, which saves money in health and social care, social security and other systems. You also talk about calling for increased investment in advice services, which is no doubt music to Polly's ears.
But how do we do this? How much additional investment are we talking about? Because increasing investment by, 1%, 5%, 10%? And what do we deprioritise to be able to afford that, given the financial straitjacket the Scottish Parliament's facing?
Thanks, Convener. I think just to come back to some of the earlier points around prioritisation, I would agree with colleagues who have said that this budget should absolutely prioritise the cost of living crisis. However, there are short-term and long-term measures to do that. So to come to the short-term measures, over the last few years, SFHA has distributed the Social Housing Fuel Support Fund element of the Fuel Insecurity Fund on behalf of the Scottish Government. That pot's been about £2 million every year for the last 3 years. And generally, it's been spent over a period of kind of 4 to 6 weeks in previous years. This year, we had £2 million worth of bids in 48 hours and £6 million worth of bids in the first week before we had to close that. We are not going to be able to meet all of the demand from housing associations to deliver on the immediate term issue of the cost of living crisis when it comes to fuel. So on the short term issues, we need more investment in direct support for people to pay their bills. Housing associations do a huge...
Yes, but the budget is shrinking in real terms. Where should that come from? Additional taxation, as we've discussed earlier on, or from other budgets? And if so, which budgets? Or it would be a combination of the two? Because this is the issue that the Finance Committee faces every year when everybody suggests we should have more money, A, now, and B, through investment in the future. But the difficulty is this financial straitjacket we're in. So we're looking for real suggestions on how we can, you know, yes, prioritise, but what do we deprioritise?
I absolutely recognise that challenge. I think what I would say is that I'm not going to tell other government departments or other areas of policy what should be deprioritised. But for me, that immediate and emergency response needs to be the number one priority for revenue funding right now. Housing associations work tirelessly to support tenants who are facing the cost of living crisis and who are in poverty. But what we're seeing is, as Steve's just described, the social infrastructure around us crumbling. So the Food Pantry Network, for example, advice services, all really struggling to provide the services that are needed. So we need to see an element of that. On the longer term response to the cost of living crisis and some of the points you raised around developing homes, there's 110,000 home target over the next 10 years. And unfortunately, we are not in a position to be delivering that given the current economic crisis. Over the last 12 months, cost of building homes increased by 17% on average across our members. Over the last 2 years or so, it's gone from £160,000 per unit to more than £200,000 per unit in most cases. That pressure is seeing contractors, the viability, the longevity of contractors at a local level put under enormous pressure. And we are really concerned that if there is not sufficient investment now, the problem only grows. And so when we talk about prioritisation, when we talk about outcomes, and the outcomes from developing affordable homes are huge for the savings people make individually. We know that the cost of renting a social home is around half the cost of renting a private home. We know there are enormous health and well-being outcomes, there are enormous economic outcomes of developing homes. That could grind to a halt over the next few years. The intervention from UK government and the outcome of that over the last few days has devalued the pound. That will only make building more expensive. If interest rates go up, that will make building for housing associations more expensive. So ultimately, we are facing a crisis in the development of homes, which will only lead to more difficult choices further down the line. That if we don't build the homes we need, the cost of the health service will increase. The number of people out of work will increase. So I completely accept the straitjacket that the Scottish Government faces here, but it's about prioritising spending that has that long-term outcomes. And I think others have spoken about using the National Performance Framework, the outcomes within that, as the lens through which we view our investment and view long-term investment. And I think both investment in new and existing homes, decarbonisation is important, and we can't get there probably in detail today. Need to be driving a lot of that. The only other point I would make just around some of the financial implications of policy developments over the last few weeks is around Scottish Government's intervention on rent. So we know that social rents in Scotland, as I said, are around half of that of the private rented sector. We also know that social rents in Scotland are lower than anywhere else in the UK, and that has been a key driver in poverty being lower in Scotland than it is anywhere else in the UK. Ultimately, that's been done without Scottish Government intervention. And having worked in Wales and having worked in other parts of the UK in the social rented sector, often government policy has driven the unintended consequences of rent increasing. And there's a real concern about what that intervention from Scottish Government does to investment. So to give just one example, because this is really important about the long-term financial implications here, ultimately, the legislation that's being proposed won't stop housing associations putting up their rents on the 1st of April if the proposals are as described. However, what it does to lender confidence is enormous. So one housing association I've spoken to in the last couple of weeks were due to refinance a £90 million facility. So around half of that was refinancing what they had already. The other half was to develop new homes. The half that was for developing new homes will now not happen because lenders have been completely spooked by Scottish Government intervening in rent policy for the first time. So when we talk about long-term consequences, long-term priorities, it is the unintended consequences we need to really explore. When it comes to rent and when it comes to the cost of living crisis, housing associations will always prioritise affordability for tenants. And we were all in a position of accepting that it would be below inflation when it comes to the 1st of April this year, because it's simply not acceptable to put rents up by inflation at the levels at which they are. That would have had an impact on the business plan, but unfortunately, the intervention over the last few weeks has made that challenge even greater.
I mean, given that a significant proportion of rents come from housing benefit, what are the Treasury implications, in other words, of additional funding coming to Scotland of the impact on Scottish housing association, Federation of Housing Associations, and indeed local authorities?
Yeah, well, we don't have exact figures, but it's between 65 and 70% of rent to housing associations would be paid by housing benefit. When the UK government cut social rents in England in 2015, the IFS did a really important piece of work which actually demonstrated that there would be almost no benefit to the tenants and all of the benefit would be felt by the Exchequer. And I'm assuming, you know, I haven't got figures in front of me, assuming it would be a very similar outcome here. Ultimately, Scotland will be losing out on investment in housing and in communities as a result of that policy. So the unintended consequence of this is the Treasury gains in London and Scottish Housing Association, Scottish tenants and Scottish communities lose out.
Well, thank you. John, to be followed by Alison.
Thanks, Convener. What was to pursue that, actually, because we hadn't had housing up till now, so now we've got it. I mean, what would the practical impact be for housing associations if they got less income, and say the freeze did go beyond March? Would you cut back on maintenance or that kind of thing? So that's my first point. And the second point is on the kind of capital expenditure. What's your thinking, if we're assuming we are going to build more houses? Well, we are. Should we be doing more on the retrofit side to try and improve heating costs and all that kind of thing? So have we got the balance right between building new houses? And I think, like, and passive house comes into that as well, because I've got some in my constituency, very high standard, but I think more expensive. How do we get the balance in there?
On the first point, that will inevitably vary from association to association, depending on their individual position. I know, given the difficulty of developing homes at the moment, a number of associations are taking decisions to either pause development programmes or consider that over the next few months. And I think development would be the first place you would look. Inevitably, the longer the impact of any rent freeze, rent cut, whatever it might look like, takes hold, that would have an impact on maintenance. And again, England is fairly instructive here with what happened with the 1% rent cut. We saw planned maintenance budgets drop off a cliff. We saw job losses and we saw, unfortunately, community investment. And I don't think that's ever really recovered in England. Community investment, the kind of social benefits of housing associations, was what ultimately suffered in that instance. And I think we may see similar here. I don't want to be alarmist, because we were looking at modest and moderate rent increases this year anyway, and would have had a situation to manage. But there are long-term consequences across a business plan. When it comes to the right balance, ultimately, we share Scottish Government's ambition to do both of these, and that requires huge amounts of investment, huge amounts of work on what supply chain looks like, and huge amounts of thought around how we get that balance exactly right. At the moment, I think the worry with retrofit is that the homes we build now will provide additional financial capacity across the business plan in future to do more of the retrofit. And if we don't build those homes, then our capacity to borrow more into the future to deliver on the decarbonisation agenda becomes constrained. So I think it needs to be a fine balance of both. But if we stop developing now, decarb becomes harder in the future.
Because a constituency like mine, I mean, I've got a whole load of sandstone tenements, which are incredibly difficult. So, and it is expensive, I accept, to retrofit them, but I sometimes wonder if we should be doing more of that.
We ultimately need to be doing more. I think at the moment we're in a phase where Scottish Government is reviewing the energy efficiency standard for social housing. The proposed second version of that standard probably didn't go far enough in terms of net zero, and for me wasn't closely linked enough to the ambitions around fuel poverty either, and we need to align those more closely in the standard. So there's a bit of work to do to get that right, and I think what's really important is that we now get the fabric stuff right, and when you look at some of those tenement buildings, you know, that's going to be really, really difficult. People are talking about heating solutions such as heat pumps and district heating. They just won't work in the tenement buildings unless you've got that fabric right in the first instance. So what we need is a clear sense of direction around what the standard's going to be following the review from Scottish Government, and as part of that work, some concerted work around what the right funding mix is, because the split we've got at the moment, which is broadly 50% government funding, 50% private lending to build a home, probably isn't going to balance out in the same way on retrofit. And we haven't quite worked out, A, what the full cost is, and B, what the right financial mix is. So I think there's three kind of actions you need to get us there and to be doing much more of it. We're probably going to need more government grant. We're going to need some concerted effort to reduce costs, probably through collective procurement, through a much more kind of national plan around what we do on retrofit. And we're going to need to unlock some of the financial constraints that housing associations have. We're probably, as a sector, not going to be able to absorb all of the lending on ourselves that will be needed, because the bill is far greater than the bill we're paying to develop homes at the moment. But there may be solutions, for example, through the National Energy Agency. Could we use that as an off-balance sheet lending vehicle? Future Generations Commissioner in Wales has done some really interesting work around how you might use the energy service company, for example, to do some of that. So I think there are solutions. We're not quite there yet. But if we can focus on the fabric first kind of approach for now, then that will set us up once we are a bit further down the line. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Alison, to follow by Ross.
To return to a point which you'd made about the consensus that we should be trying to get upstream and prevent problems in the first place rather than waiting until they become very expensive to turn around. And I think we have underestimated the potential for public health interventions, which cost little, if nothing, to the public purse, to prevent non-communicable diseases, which claim 83% of all the lives lost in Scotland each year. And just last month, a new alliance, the Non-Communicable Diseases Alliance, which is a group of 20 charities and royal colleges, published a list of 8 asks of Parliament and Scottish Government, which are for legislative changes to control the price, the availability, and how products, tobacco, alcohol, and unhealthy food products are marketed in Scotland. British Heart Foundation has estimated that around about 10,000 lives a year could be saved if we reduced the consumption of these harmful products. And I think, you know, there's a tendency to think that prevention is very much a long-term endeavour, but looking specifically at alcohol deaths, alcoholic liver disease can kill somebody very, very quickly. And I think if we look at the profile of recent deaths, the fact that we saw a 10% reduction in deaths, alcohol-specific deaths, which are 90% alcoholic liver disease in 2019, and then an increase of 17% in 2020. I think that shows you just how quickly harm can be affected by changes in levels of consumption and patterns of drinking. So there is a real short-term benefit as well as a longer-term benefit to these preventative actions, which, as I say, cost little, if anything, to implement in terms of the public spending.
Okay, thank you very much. Ross, to follow by Polly.
Thanks. I'd just like to jump back a bit to something that Claire said a couple of moments ago, because you listed some areas where public spending is going to be reduced over the next couple of years, or particularly enterprise and skills areas in particular. I don't think anybody would pretend that's a good thing, but the SCDI's position is also against any new business taxes, and also even not just an increase in income tax, but opposition to fiscal drag through keeping the rates as they are. The conclusion of all that, if there's areas that you're looking to increase spending but without any new revenue, must be that there are areas of public spending at the moment you would deprioritise elsewhere. C- Could you expand on that a little bit? Because I'm otherwise not sure how to resolve your tax position and the spending priorities that you've outlined.
We've already touched on one area where we have identified that we think there are potential efficiencies to be made in health and social care. So whilst we recognise that there are pressures there, that is one area where we think there is, you know, there could be savings to be made. And I suppose the size of the budget for health and social care relative to the cuts in other budgets, which are proportionately much smaller, would suggest that there is potentially some rebalancing that could be done.
Just one very brief follow-up to David. You made an interesting remark, I think, a while ago now in the conversation about opposition to income tax rises on those of modest income. Can I just push you a little bit to define modest income? Are we talking about the cleaners on 18 grand that Stephen mentioned, somebody on an average salary in the kind of mid-20s, or are we talking about folk on 40 grand who with fiscal drag are heading towards the point of being hit with the higher income tax rate?
Yep, sure. So we were, we haven't put this explicitly in our budget recommendations paper, but we were talking about, you know, those on the sort of bottom two or three rungs of the Scottish income tax band, so starter, basic, intermediate. And if I may, just, well, I've got you, convener. Obviously, we've put forward a number of suggestions in the paper, in our budget recommendations paper, on saving money. I guess just picking up, because I didn't get the chance to come back on what Alison was saying earlier on, we would suggest that the committee give short shrift to the idea of putting an additional business rates levy on retailers. I'm happy to follow up in writing as to why we don't support that notion.
Well, why don't you support that notion?
Well, partly for the reasons I've articulated earlier on. Retailers are already paying a poundage rate, many are paying the higher property rate on top, many will pay the business improvement district levy on top of that. I think in Alison's paper to the committee, she talked about this would be akin to the large retailers levy that was in force in the early part of the last decade. And if I remember correctly, that receipts from that cost a lot of money. Receipts from that went into the general kitty and didn't go into any specific pot in terms of preventative spend. And then I guess the third point I would make is that Alison's paper actually goes on to talk about transparency in public spend, and I think she quotes this £148 million spent on alcohol and drugs harm reduction, but it talks about it being unclear as to what that money has been spent on, and indeed goes on to say it's difficult to say if further investment is needed. So I think if money has already been spent on reducing alcohol harms, then it sounds like, based on her analysis, that needs to be the focus, making sure that's well spent as opposed to bringing in new additional taxes.
OK, I'll let Alison come in a few minutes. Just to let you know, we're already at 11 o'clock. I don't want the session to continue much longer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to let Polly and Catherine in, and then I'm going to let Alison respond to David. We'll then wind up this section. We'll then briefly ask about transparency, and then I'm giving you some due notice of this. I'm going to ask, so you're not all put on the spot, I'm going to ask all of our guests what they would prioritise if there was one thing that the Scottish Government could do in this 23-24 budget. Now, that's one, not two, three or four. One thing they would prioritise above all else in this forthcoming Scottish budget, then I want you to think about what that would be and to articulate that after we've discussed briefly transparency. So, first of all, we'll have Polly, Catherine, and then we'll have Alison. So, Polly.
That's really challenging, but I've got the floor, so I can ask for two things maybe with one just now.
Not yet. You're getting one and one only.
Yeah. I suppose Aaron already articulated a point about funding for advice services. Our advisers now are giving 20% more advice than they did in the pandemic, and we're not really into the winter yet. So there is a real crisis for citizens' advice. That's because of a long-term pattern of poor funding. And I think you were asking about how to prioritise. I think rather than what, maybe thinking about how. And I think your point about transparency is a good one in this, in that if you don't have transparency between the outcomes and where the money is being spent, then it's really hard to make decisions about where to place that money to realise best value. I think the things we would ask for is thinking about building funding systems that do allow for that transparency, that allow for that outcomes focus, and that allow for focus on preventative spend. And that really is our ask in terms of this committee, is trying to push forward that agenda and push forward the transparency, but also that relentless focus on outcomes, because that's the only way we're going to overturn some of these issues we've discussed today.
Thank you. And I noticed in your submission you said that for vulnerable clients with complex needs, there's simply no substitute for local face-to-face advice in person from a trusted, empathetic advisor. And despite the push for digitalisation, I am absolutely 100% in agreement with that, not least because I was myself a citizen advice volunteer way back in the 1980s. And just before I let Polly in, I should give the apologies of Liz Smith, who has had to leave because she has a funeral to attend. Catherine.
Thank you. I just wanted to bring together a couple of things that have been discussed so far, just to use them as an example of the kind of analysis, the gendered analysis, equality impact assessment, like the necessity of them. So in terms of the point that we were making earlier on, that Stephen and others were making around local authority cuts or efficiencies, you know, cuts to childcare, education, social care, transport, these are things that are going to impact women's ability to participate in the economy to a disproportionate extent. Women aren't just recipients of support, they're drivers of the economy. So the extent to which those cuts should be analysed for their impact on women, because if they're not, you risk a false economy in terms of making those cuts and the limitations they will place on women in terms of participating in the economy going further. The other thing that is also an example of that is digitisation. Whilst I'm entirely supportive of that agenda, there also has to be analysis about what jobs will be lost through digitisation. And often that is the lowest paid jobs, and often those jobs are done by women. And there's also an element about low-income people who are on low incomes, and women in particular, how do they access the benefits of digitisation? So this is what these are all great things to be talking about, but we need to kind of have that analysis of them. And the only other thing I wanted to mention is you've asked about what you should be prioritising and what you should be cutting. We haven't in gender done a huge amount of work on the specifics of the tax system, but what I would recommend to you is, I mean, in terms of human rights standards, it's quite clear you should be working on the minimum, safeguarding the minimum core standards for the most vulnerable. And the SHRC and the Scottish Women Budget Group have done a lot of really good work on how to kind of maximise available resources, what can be done within the limitations of Scotland's tax system around local government taxes, council taxes, what could be possible in the area of addressing tax evasion within the limitations. Now, that's not in gender's work, so I can't claim it, but I would encourage the committee to have a look at what the Scottish Human Rights Commission have done in that area.
Okay, thank you very much. So before we move on to transparency, Alison.
You know, as I mentioned earlier, the additional revenue which retailers have accrued as a consequence of minimum unit price based on the BREA assessment would amount to about £180 million over the last 4.5 years. So it's not just a question of the accrued comparison with public health supplement. There is additional money which the retailers have benefited from as a result of minimum unit price. We believe that there's proof of concept of the effectiveness of minimum unit price in reducing consumption. When we reduce consumption, the benefits are disproportionately felt in the most disadvantaged groups. So we have an opportunity here to continue to reduce health inequalities by maintaining minimum unit price, and we believe that we need to uprate it in order to ensure that we optimise the benefits going forward. In terms of the revenue from a public alcohol harm prevention levy, We do believe that there should be greater transparency over how that money is utilised, and that it should go towards alcohol treatment, where we see a massive alcohol treatment gap. Even before the pandemic, alcohol services were inadequate. The last assessment, which is now almost 10 years old,
showed that only one in four people with dependency were accessing treatment, but we now see a fifth fewer people entering treatment prior to the pandemic as when that assessment took place. So we have a big gap, although there has been a significant additional investment, as David alluded to. Most of that is earmarked specifically for drugs. And although we have a recognition from Scottish Government that we have twin public health emergencies of alcohol and drugs, the response has to date been far greater in relation to drugs than alcohol. And we're not recognising that, you know, one in 15 of all deaths in Scotland is due to alcohol. We need a proportionate response to this problem.
Okay, thank you very much. I should say my father died of alcoholism, so I'm very sympathetic to some of the comments that you've actually made. Now, we're going to move on to transparency. And question 8, if you will recall, said, how has the Scottish Government reflected its commitment to fiscal transparency in the spending review, and how can it best ensure that spending in the budget 2023-24 can be properly identified and tracked? Now, some people didn't actually answer this question in their submissions, but David, you said no comment. Why was that?
Because it's not our area of expertise and we don't have member feedback on that. And perhaps, with hindsight, I should have asked our members for views on that, convener.
Okay, fair enough. That's fairly succinct. Any other comments people want to make on transparency? Claire?
A quick point on transparency, and just a very quick point, if I may, just on the discussion we had about digitisation and productivity. I just want to be clear, I suppose, that our vision for digitisation of public services, we hope, is a positive one, one that allows every employee in public services to have the tools. So we're all sitting here with phones and laptops and what have you. We all have the tools we need to do our jobs, and also one where service users can choose to receive that service in a way that suits them. So it's about choice, I think. But anyway, I hope that's come across as a...
an issue about digital exclusion, but we won't go into that.
Well, no, I totally agree. It's about designing it to ensure that it's that people aren't excluded. Just on the point of transparency, we've made a recommendation for something called a prosperity impact. It doesn't exist at the moment, but it's something that we'd be happy to contribute some thoughts on what it might look like. But I think it's really going back to my earlier points about thinking about spending, and you know, during the COVID pandemic, we talked about the four harms to the economy and health, etc. And I think it's not losing sight of that. And you know, the discussion today, I suppose, hopefully, we've tried to make the point that you know, we need to think about how we're going to grow the economy long term. So we would encourage you to think about spending and assessing spending proposals also in the context, not just in terms of outcomes, but how they're contributing to Scotland's long term economic prosperity.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments on this issue, David?
thank you, convener. I guess just on the broader point about transparency, you know, one of the upsides of the arrangement we have is at the moment is that the finance secretary, presumably November, December time, will make an announcement about tax rates, and that gives employers and obviously individuals as well a few months of a sense of what they have to do to make that happen, to make it work, and can work out the budget implications for them. So I think that's a good thing. We're in favour of as much predictability and certainty as possible as well. So clearly, if you were to shift away from, say, the business rates being set by ministers to councils, there might be a risk that councils will set the business rate at the time they set their own council budgets for the year, which, if I understand it, tends to be sort of February time, which is obviously only just a handful of weeks before the start of the new financial year. So anything that can give more predictability and certainty is a good thing. I think I'm right in saying that in the programme for government, there is a commitment to a review of regulation. We're hoping that comes up in the emergency budget review statement, which I'm assuming is over the next week or two, and in order to give as much certainty to firms going forward as to what is going to be progressed in terms of devolved regulation, but also what's going to be paused or indeed jettisoned.
Well, I mean, we, of course, are committed to carry out pre-budget scrutiny and trying to influence through the evidence we take from organisations and people like yourselves that draft budget. And then, of course, we scrutinise the budget itself over a number of weeks, including in the Chamber itself through debate, whereas in the UK, the Chancellor just stands up and says, this is a budget, you know. So it's quite interesting looking at the different systems. Anyone else want to comment on transparency? If not, we'll move on. Sorry, Stephen.
It's not my area of expertise, I have to say, but I do think that experience in workplaces is that the greater engagement with the workforce, the better. Some of the innovations and some of the solutions to some of the problems are better found by engaging with more people. And I appreciate that's dead easy to say and difficult to structure how that would happen, but I do think that there's a greater need for greater engagement. And frankly, this part of it is illustrated by some of the discussion we've had here, where ideas are floating around the table and you quite rightly could throw back at us, aye, but what about? And that's the kind of process which I think is necessary. So I would just say that the greater engagement from a trade union perspective would be appreciated, and I'm sure that various other stakeholders would also want that. Now, how that's manufactured or how you create that, I'm not sure about, but I think the more open we are about these discussions, the better.
I mean, I couldn't agree more. I mean, I worked in the third sector and the public and private sector, and I was working in the private sector. There was a staff suggestion scheme, and it had almost no impact. You know, how can the company save money and do things better and better? And I said, why don't you incentivise people so that they get a share of their savings? And so the company brought in a scheme whereby employees could get up to 10% of what they actually saved by doing things more efficiently. And they were absolutely inundated by suggestions because if there was actually a reward for the people who were actually making those suggestions. Now, obviously, they weren't all implemented, but I think there's, you know, that incentive had, you know, it certainly stuck with me. Okay, anyone else on transparency before I go on to the number? Okay, Catherine?
Very, very brief point, just to, you know, as part of that. What's really needed in the longer term is better data in terms of budget decision making. At the moment, you just don't have access to kind of good enough data in terms of, particularly from my point of view, equality-based data, disaggregated by gender, etc. So you're not really able to track impact to the extent, and that a lot of the decision making and how it's aimed at addressing these issues, there's not sufficient through lines in terms of transparency, because a lot of the time you don't have the, you know, good enough data to be making the decisions about impact.
Okay, that's very helpful. Okay, I'm going to move on then, seeing as this topic hasn't set the heather alight, to everyone's number one budget priority. So I'm going to ask for volunteers who wants to go first to say what they are, and I keep emphasising their number one budget priority. David.
Well, if I may, just to lighten the point you made, Convener, if the government take forward any of the suggestions for savings in our budget recommendations paper, then very happy to get 10% of the savings emanating from that. Might help pay for any of Alison's tax increases she wants to see increase. But joking aside, we've got six recommendations, key recommendations in our paper. I think you've challenged us to lighten just one. On the basis that Mr. Swinney might take forward some ideas on income tax, I will focus instead on something that can help keep down shop prices, which is to rule out an increase in the business rate in the coming financial year. That would be our top recommendation.
Thank you very much. Okay, anyone else wish to go forward? Catherine?
Just very briefly, I would say, you know, investing in women and investing in women who are on low incomes has a major return for society and for the economy. It builds more resilient communities. So what I would say is the one thing is that, you know, invest in women on low incomes through social security and improving the social care system in Scotland, but also for this particular committee, make sure that the decision making that you're making as part of this budget process aren't having untold, unseen consequences that will worsen inequality.
Okay, thank you. What's going next, Claire? And then Aaron?
It's a broad one, admittedly, but yes, to ensure that the recommendations and the delivery plan for the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is properly funded.
Thank you very much. And Aaron?
If we want to deliver the 110,000 home target over the next 10 years, we need to act now. So it needs to be around investment in affordable housing and the associated benchmarks increasing in line with costs.
Okay, thank you. Stephen?
I would suggest that the government is persuaded to drop its current proposals on the National Care Service, and the monies that would then be saved would be invested directly into improving care, including specifically introducing the sectoral bargaining, which would address the issues within the care workforce to improve the situation for them.
Thank you very much. That's very clear. Alison? And then Polly.
An alcohol harm prevention levy on retailers to recoup the additional profits from minimum unit price. That would only require secondary legislation, very quick and easy to implement.
Thank you very much. And Polly, last word is with you.
Yeah, for us, any measures that get cash into people's pockets, so whether that is direct cash support to people or services like ours, which support income maximisation.
Thank you very much. That's very clear also. So I'm going to wind up this session now, and I want to thank everyone for their very helpful contributions, which of course we will put into a report, and we'll certainly be questioning the Deputy First Minister, who's also the Finance Secretary, of course, on these when he comes before us. So thank you very much. I'm now going to call a break until 11:30, when we will go into private session.